Roll my chains. To follow the glory of the Lord. So this is let's be still for a minute. Good morning.
I'm supposed
to say that because they say that's always what I say twice, right?
Good morning, good morning.
Good morning, good morning. Good morning. They're beginning to tell me I'm predictable. Have y'all figured that out?
No, no, never.
Not at all, not at all, not at all. Well, blessed Resurrection Sunday. This is a good day.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. This is a good day. When you sit here and look at why we're excited about Resurrection Sunday, I want to draw your attention to the fact that there are a lot of religions in this world. How many of you know that?
Yes.
There's a lot of religions in this world. And a lot of them, their leaders died. Matter of fact, all of them did.
Yes.
The only difference between those religions and ours is today. Ours rose from the dead.
Woo-hoo!
See? So it makes a big difference, you know. And they'll say, well, we don't know that he rose from the dead. Oh, yeah, we do. Because we have historical evidence. We have scriptural evidence. We have testimony after testimony. So the difference is, theirs all said they were the God, but they didn't come back from the dead. And I think so often we think, well, why is that such a big deal? Well, it's symbolic to you and I. When God created the first humans in the garden, he gave them eternal life. Eternal life. But they sold it. They messed up. And when they did, they basically sold it so that they would live eternally, but they would never live with him as his family. So it makes a big difference when you think that he had to figure out a way to come back and rescue his semi-not intelligent children. Notice I didn't say stupid. I'm trying not to say those words today. Semi-not intelligent children. That would be us. I notice that a lot of times when I'm witnessing about Jesus and talking about Jesus, the problem is people don't realize they sin. I mean, when you tell them you're a sinner, they're like, really? How am I a sinner? I'm better than so-and-so. You know, I'm nice to my wife. I'm nice to my children. I'm better than so-and-so. Why am I a sinner? Okay. And the whole point being they don't understand why they needed Jesus, because they don't understand their sinning. You get this, right? In fact, the world has told them if they do this and this, they're okay. They're fine. So it becomes a problem when a lot of people try to evangelize. They are trying to evangelize in the middle of the book by quoting them what Jesus did without establishing first why we need a Savior. To tell somebody you're a sinner isn't going to get them Jesus, right? They're just going to think, well, I've seen you, and I'm just as good as you are. That's how they judge us. So today, Resurrection Day is a big thing, but we have to start the story for a lot of people we're witnessing to is how God created us in the garden. Start with that story. And as you share that story, then you can tell how we got bought, sold into slavery, and how now, because of that, he needs to have a rescuer, someone who comes in and buys us back from the evil. When you give it to them in that perspective, then they can understand, oh, it's not just all me. It's what's happened to all of all of humanity. So therefore we are. This is the 18th day of Nissan. So I want you to remember that date a lot, because we're going to talk about it today. The 18th day of Nissan was in Jesus' Passover week, the week he did all of his feats and deeds. The 18th was a Sunday. So interesting enough, this year, the 18th falls on a Sunday. So we can actually say Resurrection Sunday. Most of the time we can't. Now, we all like to celebrate Resurrection Sunday on Sunday, even though it's on usually a different calendar day. But this year, interesting enough, it falls in that place. So I want to bring some different things to you today. We've been celebrating Passover. We celebrated that this week, and most of you have had your Passover Seders. Had a little bit more in involvement in knowing what Jesus did at that time. But really, Passover was just that one day, and then the next days are the days of unleavened bread. So it becomes an 8-day feast, because we got a Passover day and 7 days of unleavened bread. But as Resurrection Sunday and Passover week, we've often heard it called Holy Week or Passion Week, right? And that's accurate. That is accurate. It's one of the most holy weeks there is. But there's a pattern in Passover that a lot of times we miss. We misunderstanding why Resurrection Sunday or Resurrection Day came on the way it did and how it did. One of the things that I've noticed is that tradition isn't a very good indicator of truth. Can you all hear me? Tradition isn't a very good indicator of truth. But because it's come down so long, if you will read research on how many of you have ever heard of the word Good Friday? Mm-hmm. Okay. That's all we were taught. Did you know that? And we were taught that because of some incorrect tradition. It's not scriptural, but they make it scriptural by quoting different things without using all of the evidence of the word. How many of you know people that just love to pull out one section of the Bible? And that's the one they build their whole denomination around? Just this little piece? Well, the beauty is God gave us the whole book for a reason. He gave us several different versions of even the Gospels. How many of you realize that? Yep, we all realize that. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Totally different versions in a lot of ways. They had similar stories. But a lot of times one would forget something we would think would be epic, and the next person spent 2 chapters on it. And you're thinking, how did that all fit? Well, when you're trying to figure things out, like when did Jesus actually do his Passover week, and when did he die, and all of those things, you have to take all of the evidence of all of the versions into account and understand why they are saying what they are saying. Because a lot of people would say that the reason they chose to say Good Friday was the day that Jesus was crucified is because in several of the versions it talks about a Sabbath. Well, the Jews only did a traditional weekly Sabbath on Friday evening. So in their version, he had to have died on Friday so that it would fit they were in preparation for the Sabbath. But unless they knew their Jewish roots, they wouldn't understand that in Passover and that week, there were 2 Sabbaths, 2 holy days, 2 recognizable days. And they wouldn't have included that in their information. So it makes them come up with the wrong timing. I don't know how, I've had them explain it to me a million times, the 3 days and 3 nights that Jesus was supposed to be in the grave.
Yeah.
Y'all know that. Even in your best mathematical whiz day, Friday to Sunday, Friday evening to Sunday morning is not 3 days. Okay. I mean, maybe it's new math, I don't know. I'm going to leave it at that. But I'm just saying it's not workable. So one of the things I'm going to ask you to do today is to suspend from your knowing some of the facts you've been taught, that this is true, this is true, this is true. Because I actually had one research article say, the reason we know this is true is because our ancestors did this on that day. I'm thinking, well, ex-nay that research right there. Okay. Because in my family, I'll give you an example. Gary and I laugh about it all the time. On this day, no one in my family ever said Resurrection Sunday. They always said Easter. And we always had ham. Mm-hmm. Is that not true?
Yeah.
Okay. Did you realize that?
Yes.
And I'm saying for all of you that are having ham today, your sins are forgiven. And it's not a big deal. Okay. But do you see how we kind of wrap that all up together? Okay. Now, we used to laugh because my mother, when she would get a ham, no matter what size it was, she would always cut off one end and then the other end. And we're all like, why are you cutting the ham off? She goes, it's how you cook it. And I go, why? Now, see, I'm a home ec major in one of those things. And I go, well, Mom, why are you cutting the ends of the ham off? And she goes, well, it's what my mother always did. And I said, well, let's ask your mother why she cut off the ends of the ham. And when we did, she said, oh, that's easy. Mine was always too big to fit in the pot. Do you see how tradition gets started? Now, my mother could not cook. Let's make that abundantly clear. Her idea of cooking was pre-made Sam's or Walmart. You know what I'm saying? And we all were thrilled to have that, as opposed to other things. So, do you see how tradition can mess us up truly in what we are doing? So I'm going to give you just the chapters that I'm going to encourage you to read this week. Yep, she's giving you homework. The first one is Matthew 26. These are the chapters that tell you about this week, tell you about resurrection, tell you about what Jesus was doing and what the disciples were doing and all the things. Each of the four Gospels has a section that's talking about it. So either write these down somewhere or commit them to memory or put a marker in your Bible or something. But Matthew 26 is where Matthew starts his discussion about the Lord's Supper, about all the things that's happening, and his version of what's there. Mark 14 is Mark's version. And if you'll notice, I'm giving you all these things so today, after I explain a little bit more of it, when you go back and read it, you'll get different opinions, you'll get different messages coming through. That's what Holy Spirit wants to do. He wants to be your moving truth today. Luke 22 is the chapter where Jesus is talking about it with Luke and his version of how. And all of these chapters are Nissan 14. Okay, so you need to put that in your head. Nissan 14 was the Passover day, the day the lamb was slain, the day they did their Passover. And then in John, the interesting thing about John is John has all the chapters from 13 through 20. Okay. 13 through 20 were John's chapters. And he had a lot of teachings that Jesus did during that whole week and places he was and everything he was there. It's quite interesting when you look at it. So how you celebrate this week, how you have celebrate even this day, depends really on your relationship with Jesus. We call Jesus Yeshua HaMashiach. And what we say is there are levels of a relationship with Jesus. And we can look at the scripture and see that. So I want you to figure out, where are you in your relationship to Jesus? Which one of these groups do you fall into? Okay. There were thousands of people that followed Jesus around. Thousands. All right. That's a lot of entourage. Okay. But they would always show up. But they were showing up because of the signs, the wonders, and the miracles. That's that group of people. Then 300 really stayed close to him because they wanted to know him. They wanted to know what was going on. They wanted to have information, knowledge. They wanted to be there. And these levels of relationship I got from a lady named Nancy Cohen, C-O-E-C-E-O-E-N. And she has an amazing teaching on thousands of things, but this is my favorite on these relationships. Then he had 120 that wanted to obey the command of the Lord. Key word is obey. These are the ones that showed up in the upper room when he told everybody to go to the upper room. There were lots that the 300 could have gone, but only 120 went. You realize this. So there is a level of relationship where you just obey. You don't ask questions. You don't negotiate. You don't try and compromise. And you don't try and reason it out. You just obey. Then there was the 70 that he sent out. They laid hands on people. He told them to go forth, to cast out demons, raise the dead, do miraculous healing signs and wonders. Those are the 70. Okay. Then there were 12 that were handpicked. Those 12 actually lived with him, okay, in every sense of the word. They talked to him. They were with him day and night, all the time. Then there were 3 of those 12 that wanted more. They absorbed everything he did. In fact, he would pull them aside with him a lot of times because they were wanting more. It wasn't enough to be able to do signs, wonders, and miracles. It wasn't enough to obey God. It wasn't enough to do those things. They wanted more than all the 12. Okay, those, and they were Peter, James, and John. Those were those. And then there was one that identified in glory with God, but he also identified in his sufferings. Just one. Because if you identify in his sufferings, then you will walk through these things. You will be rejected. You will be accused. You will be slandered. You will be blasphemed. You will be called a heretic. You will be defiled. You will be beaten. And you will be whipped, maybe not with an actual cat of nine tails, but you'll be whipped with words. And you will be hung on a cross. In other words, you will put your life on a cross. So what level of relationship do you have with your Lord Jesus? We all think in terms of, well, I'm there, but you realize John is the only one that actually died a natural death. All the others died a horrible death with different forms of torture and murder and everything else. John, they tried to kill him. Do you remember how they tried to kill him? Hung him upside down in a vat of boiling oil. Dunked him in and pulled him out. And he was still alive and not burned. Wow. I don't know. That sounds like suffering to me to go in and come out. Do you see the difference? So when we think about this day, we're all going to celebrate it a little bit different depending on what your relationship is with Jesus, what he is saying your goal is. I want to show you a clip before I get started on showing the different things, so I'll let Kevin see if we can get this up. I want to start by saying, you know, you can't really see the stars unless you have darkness. Most of you don't particularly like darkness, whether it's natural darkness or spiritual darkness. But you cannot see the bright shining stars unless you're in that place. Okay. And today I want to show you how the stars literally have a set picture that happens not only at the birth of Jesus, not only the star of the Bible, not only the crucifixion. Now, the crucifixion happened during the day. How could they see the stars when it turned dark? We're going to talk about that today. So I want to show you this little clip that kind of describes what the skies look like and how they come into play with what Jesus is wanting us to do. We're going to forward a little bit. Just give us a minute. Because if I gave you all of this, you all would be off on another trail. Mm-hmm. And then I would have to pull you back. So we're not pulling you back today.
Scrolls, and it mentions Sirius, the bands of Orion, and the Pleiades in Job, which we'll get to later. Now, because the vernal equinox comes earlier and earlier, at first it appeared in the constellation of the twins. So when Cain killed his twin brother Abel after the spring sacrifice, the sun, the vernal equinox, was eclipsing or in front of the constellation of the twins. 2,000 years later, when Abraham divided the two cows and God did the blood walk and made a covenant of blood between Abraham and himself, and Abraham, of course, was the most famous astrologer in the Old Testament. He was a pagan astrologer. His father, Terah, had taught him about the idols and the mythology and all the graffiti of astrology. And he cast away his father's idols. And when he got rid of the pagan notion of the idols, God made friends with him with cross-cultural communication. He took him out and he showed him this sky. And Abraham, he told Abraham, count the stars. Tell the stars, tell the number of the stars. And that was the word cipher. He told Abraham to decipher and showed him his position in this particular prophetic clock. 2,000 years, and that's when the Passover occurs, when the blood was pushed on the lintel and on the doorpost, and it was dipped in the basin of the blood, which is the dip you get in a stone house threshold. And it was also when Joseph was a priest of On, which is an Apis, Serapis, Hathor bull cult. And it was also when the golden calf incident occurred. So the dominant thing in the heavens, as in heaven, so on earth, the sun was in the constellation of the bull during that era. 2,000 years after that, Jesus comes. The Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world arrives. And at his crucifixion, the sun was in the constellation of the ram until noon. Noon is the sixth hour. And from the sixth hour through the seventh hour and the eighth hour until the ninth hour, for 3 hours, the sun went dark. And when the sun went dark, these signs were visible to anybody that knew how to interpret them. The people who interpreted them were outside. The people who were righteous Israelites that did not pay attention to the sky were inside preparing for Passover. But this is the witness to the whole world. And they would look up and see that the sun had gone out in the ram for 3 hours. 1 hour for each of the Godhead, from the sixth hour, the number of man, where he sacrificed himself for us, through the seventh hour, which is the number of completion of, but payment of a fine, completion of a legal obligation, and eight, the number of new beginnings at the resurrection, having the sun come back into that constellation before the ninth hour, which is the number of judgment, where Jesus spared us that judgment by his death on the cross. The sun came out once he had died. Once he died, he launches what we now know as the Christian church. And he had a little boy bring him 2 fish and 5 loaves. The 2 fish are the symbol of the fishers of men in the missionary church age till the present day. So for the last 2,000 years, the vernal equinox at Passover in the spring has been in the constellation of the fish. We are on the cusp, on the verge of going from the fish, missionary church, fishers of men age, into the Aquarius, waterman, millennial temple, waters pouring forth of Ezekiel 47 in the constellation of the waterman. When Jesus is on the cross, he sees to his left Cain killing his brother Abel. He sees the sacrifice, the bull sacrifice, and the dividing and the covenant with Abraham in Taurus the bull. He sees the golden calf idolatry of it. He sees his own sacrifice in the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world in the constellations before him. And then he sees the future of the fish for the next 2,000 years and ends up with the sun in the millennial temple with his return at about this period in history. So at the nativity, the shepherds could see the history of the world from Cain and Abel all the way to the millennial temple. When Jesus was on the cross, he could see the history of the world from Cain and Abel all the way to the millennial temple. During the Christmas season and during the season of Hanukkah, the same sky appears now in modern times because of precession.
Okay. So the sky of the nativity is the sky of the crucifixion.
Isn't that kind of amazing? Mm-hmm. Did you get that? I'm going to have a test at the end of the message today, see if you've got all that. The important thing is for you to understand that God was even giving clues. He's always been giving clues in the stars to back up what is in the written word. And when you put the pieces together, and I don't know if you understood what he was saying, but the vernal equinox, or the springtime of everything, is when Passover was and is. And so what happens is, because of this precession, every 2,000 years, the sun, which is in the Passover season, moves from one constellation to another. That's why the beginning with Cain and Abel was in one constellation. When Abraham got there and Passover was instituted, it was in the constellation of the bull. That's why when Jesus did his crucifixion 2,000 years after that, that the constellation was the ram or the lamb. And the lamb is almost always kneeling or down like he is slain. And then now for you and I, when we celebrate Passover, the constellation for this last 2,000 years has been in the Pisces, in the fishes. It's just now moving to the Aquarius or the waterman, all right? Because we're moving out of the missionary church. We're moving out of that place where we're supposed to be there to the kingdom church. Do you see what he's trying to show you? So why is this important? It's important because we've all been told different things that are not correct. So let me make some statements. Jesus Christ observed what was called the Essenean or Essene Passover. It happened on Tuesday evening with his disciples in the upper room. It was one day before the Jews observed Passover on Wednesday evening. Uh-oh. See, we're already messing up here. But I'll show you how it works. At the time of Jesus, there were three basically Jewish groups. One were the Pharisees, one were the Sadducees, and one were the Essenes. Okay. And what we now know, in looking at all the stuff, if we put all these dates together, when you look at what it says about scripture and about where the constellations will be, and it has it in all the word, it has the prophecy of it, you will find that there is a day, and that you can write this down. Jesus Christ was crucified on Wednesday, Nissan 14th, on 3790. Okay, that's when he was crucified. It was the Passover preparation day in Jewish reckoning. Now, in the Gregorian calendar, that would transfer to April the 3rd. In the Julian calendar, it would transfer to April the 5th of 30 AD. It was not Good Friday. Okay, it was not Good Friday. So I want to, one of the things is that you will see that in the different scriptures, they talk about Pharisees, they talk about different things. And the Pharisees accused Jesus of being a Samaritan in John 8:48, because he denied their teachings and traditions. The denial included the Pharisees' traditions of when holy days were determined. But Jesus kept the temple festivals, which were based on Sadducean and Samaritan system determined by the new moon. He was actually more in alignment with the Essenes. As a matter of fact, how many of you have ever heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls? Mm-hmm. Those were Essenes. Okay, they're the ones who created them. They lived a very simple life. They lived from about 150 before Christ to about 70 AD, they had all these different places where they just gave themselves to the Lord. And as we compare their beliefs to actually what is happening when Jesus was teaching, they fit those beliefs more than they fit any other beliefs, Pharisee or Sadduceeical. And that's what happened. So one of the things that we have to understand is that in writing these Gospels, some of these disciples would have had a little bit different training or upbringing, okay? So for example, the Judeans and the Sadducees believed that the day was sunset to sunset, okay? John was in this group. That's why if you look at it, the way he talks about it, you'll find out that he's telling you about Sabbath and all of that. The Galileans, which were Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they were not the Judeans, they were the Galileans. When they looked at things, they thought more like the Pharisees. It was sunrise to sunrise. Okay, those are examples of how they are different. Now, why does that make any difference to us? Well, because when they're writing their scripture and doing their stuff, they're doing it from this mindset. They're doing it from where they are coming from. So I want to give you some just ideas. You remember when we talked about in the Passover with the Egyptians and Moses? On the 10th of Nisan, they were supposed to go out and get a lamb. Do you remember that? And then they were supposed to keep them for 4 days in their house until the lamb would be slain. Well, if we put it into connection to where Jesus is riding in and doing all these things, Jesus actually rode in on his colt on Palm Sunday. Passover lamb was selected on the 10th of Nisan. So when they talk about Palm Sunday, well, he rode in on this lamb. He was the lamb that was secured. Do you see how that works? So then, for the next few days, he does all this teaching. He goes to different places. It says this is where he questions, his authorities questioned in the temple. It's where he has goes to Bethany. If you look at it, it gives you all those places of where he came in. And then on the evening of the 13th, okay, and which is, remember in the way the Hebrews count it, sunset to sunset. On that evening of the 13th, that when he would have said to his disciples, go up and make ready a Passover. Go find the guy that's going to do our Passover. Do you remember we read that last week? Well, this is an Essenean Passover. This is why it was different from the timing of what the Pharisees would have had their Passover time. And that's why it turned out to be different. So on the evening of the, what we would say would be that Tuesday evening, which would really be Wednesday now, we have an example of where Jesus did his Lord's Seder on that night, on the 14th. And on the 14th is Nisan 14th. Again, everything that happened from then on out is on that day. All right. So that day would be considered Wednesday. So from the what you would say, today is Sunday. And if we were looking at the calendar, this would have happened his time last night when the sun went down. And so it would go from last night till the sun went down till tonight with the sun went down. It's hard because a lot of them tried to make it sound like he did all these different things on different days, but he didn't. He actually, this is where he did the Seder that evening on the 14th, which again, remember, it's sunset to sunset. Then he prayed and did his work in Gethsemane. This is where the Pharisees captured him. Remember who had captured him. It wasn't the Sadduceans, it was the Pharisees. They captured him and they interrogated him all night long. The rooster crows, and then Jesus is brought before the Sanhedrin. The Jews avoid being defiled so that they might eat their Passover coming that night. Okay, coming that evening. So Pilate interrogates Jesus, and Jesus is taken to Herod, then back to Pilate. Pilate has Jesus scourged, frees Barabbas, and orders Jesus' crucifixion. And this was about the sixth hour of the morning, or what you and I would call the morning of the 14th. So then, Passover preparation, Jesus is crucified during the darkness between the sixth hour, which is noon, to the ninth hour. And then Jesus is taken down from the cross and entombed, and the women later return to bring spices. This is all happening on the 14th. Every bit of this is happening on that one day. So, because he had to fulfill what was said. So he was actually in his tomb by the beginning of the 15th day. Mm-hmm. Okay. So at the 15th day, this is when the Jews would have had their Passover night. Interesting. That's why they said we have to get him down before we start our Sabbath. Okay. after they did that, then it was starting the days of holy bread, which is the unleavened bread fruit. And then, on somewhere on Saturday night, because see, in like if we're looking at it this week is mimicking very close to what his week was. So sometime between last night at sunset and this morning, Jesus would have resurrected from the dead. Okay. Because the resurrection is noted because the women came early in the morning and he was already gone. This is the 18th day, which is 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Okay. They came really early on that Sunday, and that's why they call it the Lord's Day. That's why they called it Resurrection Sunday. It's because originally on that calendar, that's what it did. What we've since had happen is that they want resurrection to come on Sunday. Okay? So what they do is they've made up a list of rules of how you get resurrection on Sunday. Okay? But what they did is they ended up just using, well, after the big full moon, and the next one after that in Nissan, we're going to do it is that Sunday. So again, I don't think the Lord's going to probably dent in us or delete any of us, because we don't get it always perfect. Okay. Mm-hmm. Praise God. Because we've been doing it a long time wrong. Mm-hmm. But he does want us to understand that there are 3 days and three nights. And that's really important. The two Sabbaths, were the big thing. There was actually two Sabbaths that happened, because if Passover always has as a high holy day, it always has an extra day of convocation along with wherever it falls in the week. So let me give it to you in a different way. This vernal equinox that you saw up there, when you're looking at it, I want you to envision that here is Jesus. He gets put on the cross somewhere around 9 o'clock, and he hangs there till noon. And at noon, which is called the sixth hour, the sun went dark. Okay. So Jesus is hanging on a cross and he's facing south. And the sky that you saw is what he's now seeing as he's hanging on that cross. He's seeing that he is finishing what God has sent him to do. So he sees the beginning of time, Adam, Cain, and Abel. He sees what happens with Abraham. He sees where he's supposed to be slain so that he can birth back God's family or the church. And then he gets to see where they're going to be the missionaries that go out and rescue the world by taking what he has procured and giving it to them again. And then he even gets to look and see where in the end the kingdom gets to come. So he's sitting here looking at this and seeing all this. When you're reading those chapters this week, I want you to realize that when the earth went dark, is when they saw the truth and the stars. And he could actually hear God speaking back to me. This is why you did this. This is what you did this for. one of the problems that we have is we often look at what day Jesus was born on, and everybody wants to, I mean, if you'll look at most denominations, we have the Palm Sunday, we have the Good Friday, we have all these different things. We don't want to get religious about it. What I want you to understand is Palm Sunday really happened, okay? And it only comes around every 15 and a half years that it actually coincides with the days of the week that were in that calendar. Does that make sense? And so the religious people didn't like the fact that Resurrection Day didn't come on Sunday. So that's why they shifted everything and made everything change so they could put it all together in their little format. What really is important to you and I is that the crucifixion happened, but that the resurrection happened.
Amen.
And that's where we want to be. So I think it's interesting when you study the word, you find in Psalm 68:18 that he was supposed to go according to prophecy and reach in and gather out those who were captive. He would free the captives. In other words, he would free those that were dead. Okay. So all the years before Jesus lived, there were a lot of good people, okay, that died. But they didn't have the Savior. They didn't have Jesus. And I don't know if we've ever thought about it. This is why some of your religions will talk about purgatory. Okay. They were in a holding tank. How do you like that? But what it's basically saying is they were still dead. They did not have eternal life with God, even though they had served God. Are you understanding that? Because the reason they would be brought back into the family of God had not yet come back. So a lot of times people don't like that 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth or in the grave like Jonah. But what Jesus was doing was paying. Three things that he would have to have paid for. One is he would have had to pay for the things that happened to you physically. Sickness, death, disease, physically. Because you're made up three parts, correct? So when he was being beaten and all of those things they were doing, and as he hung on the cross, he was paying for you physically. Second is he would have to pay for your redemption of your soul. Okay. How many of you ever had soul pain? Is there a person here that's never had soul pain? Then you're probably not functioning. Because of all of us have had soul pain. We hurt. Now, we can't say we hurt anywhere on the outside. I mean, our body doesn't necessarily hurt. But what hurts? Your heart, your soul, that thing inside of you just hurts and hurts. Especially if it's related to someone we love. Okay. It just tears us up, doesn't it? Okay. It just tears us up. All of those things, depression, anxiety, every emotion you can think of, Jesus was paying for it, starting with the Garden of Gethsemane. In the garden, he was travailing. He was travailing. And it was so difficult. Remember, he even brought his three with him, the three that were in the relationship with him. He brought them. And what would happen over and over again is he would go off to pray. And as he was praying, these three that were supposed to be praying with him, what'd they do? Sleep. Not once, not twice. But three times they fell asleep. And in that prayer that night, it says very clearly that it was so hard on him that he literally asked the Father if this particular cup could pass from him, but he wasn't talking about could you take away the agony and the pain of this soul infliction, of this intercession I'm doing. He didn't ask for that. What he was saying is, if you don't do something, I'm going to die here. Because the pain was so much. The pain was so great in that garden that if you don't do something, God, I'm not going to be able to fulfill what I'm supposed to be, which is I die on the cross. You see the difference? He knew that. The enemy was after him. He was carrying the weight. Do you know how hard it is to carry your pain, your agony? Multiply it 10 times. How about 100? How about 1,000? How about a billions, billions? Can you imagine? That's why he was sweating blood. Because the pain, the intercession of that was so great that God, he was saying to God, I'm physically not going to be able to carry this if you don't do something. And I'm going to die right here in the garden before we even get this done. That was him paying for that pain. And so God sent an angel to minister to him and to give him enough strength that he could finish his job. And then we know on the cross, when it got to be that noon hour, we know that all the sin of the world was now placed on him. Do you know how much trouble you have dealing with your sin? Your mistakes, your flaws, I'm not worthy, I can't do this, I failed too many times. Imagine everybody's sin. Okay, I don't think we ever get this. Everybody's sin. Do you all know any bad people? All their sin. You see, everybody, not only those that were living then, those that had ever lived, those that were living now, and those that were going to be living in the future, all of that sin. Can you imagine the weight of that? Can you imagine the weight of that? And that's when we hear the words, by God, why have you forsaken me? His translation is better to say he understood why God was doing this, because the sin was so great that God had to make the day dark and make it so that everybody could see why he was doing this. And then it says that he gave up his life. He gave up his last breath. They didn't take it from him, because it would have been easy to do hanging on the cross. But he gave it up. When he did, immediately his spirit and his soul were captured by Satan and taken into the deepest, darkest heart of the earth. What do you think he was paying for in hell? What part of you was he paying for in hell? The spirit. He was sitting here going, I want your spirit set free. I want all of you set free. I don't want just your physical body to be set free. I don't want just your soul to be set free. I need your spirit to be set free, so that Satan can no longer hang on to you and keep you bound in hell. So 3 days and three nights, you know, have any of you ever been tormented by dreams? Or scared? Or afraid? Or anxiety? Or a life or death situation? In hell, when he would have been there, all of that would have been happening around him constantly. Can you imagine all the demons of the world and the other worlds sitting there tormenting him? And yet he knew he had to stay there 3 days and three nights. I am thrilled forever that he had an internal clock. And he knew. But even in that, it says that when the right time was ready, Holy Spirit came on him and pulled him out just like that. I have this visual image, and I'm sure it has to do with my movie mindset, but I have this visual image of them torturing and torturing and torturing. And what you're not understanding is it's not torturing in one dimension. He was tortured in every dimension that you can possibly even pretend exist for 3 days and three nights. And as he's being tortured, I can just see him just passively not saying a thing. Because if he had uttered a word, the angels would have come quickly. But he had to pay for it. He had to endure everything that you could possibly ever come up against. Everything. Every demon challenge, every demon curse, he had to pay for it and endure it so you could be set free. So when he says, your sins are forgiven, he meant it. Do you realize he kept saying over and over and over again as he was being tortured physically, Father, forgive them. Father, forgive them. When they nailed him, Father, forgive them. Do you realize this? Over and over and over again. So he's mentally having all this pressure and all these things. And I can just see him at the exact hour just standing up with the power of Holy Spirit coming through him and reaching his hands out and saying, I'll take the keys now. The keys to all the kingdoms that the enemy stole. The keys to all the people the enemy stole. The keys to getting you across that big chasm. I'll take the keys now. And the enemy had no other recourse because he had paid for it. If he had not paid every last thing, he wouldn't have got the keys. But he paid for it all. Absolutely all of it. So when he gets the keys, now he can come back and do what he's needing to do. It says that the first ascension, he basically went to the heavens and he took his own blood and he poured it out on the Ark of the Covenant, on the mercy seat. Because it only needed to be done one time if you paid for everything. Why is that so important for you and I today? It's important because if you don't understand all he paid for, you will try and carry some of it yourself. Okay. You will not take advantage of it already being paid for. You will try to pay for it yourself. You will try and act like, well, I deserve this. I deserve to be miserable. Or I deserve not to have this. Or whatever. But one of the things that we must understand is he's finished it. He said, it is finished. I did it. It's all done. Physical, soul, and spirit. I've done it all. I've done it so that you can now be who you were designed to be. I've done it so that you can now do a spiritual exchange with me. Every time you recognize a sin or something that's a curse or something that the enemy's trying to bring you that is not who you were originally designed to be, it's your privilege, your right, and your legal thing you can do is say, here, Father, I realize I have this thing that's not from you. And I'm asking to do a spiritual exchange with you. Here's the thing. Now, I want what you already procured as victory to come back into me. Now, for some of you, you'll get it so well, it'll be just like that. And you won't have any more problems. But for some of you, you've had so much tradition and habit inside of you that you will have to work out your salvation. You'll have to keep repeating, nope, I already exchanged that. Nope, I already exchanged that. Nope, I already exchanged that. Over and over until you believe it. Because in the spirit world, Satan does not care how intelligent you are or how many degrees you have. Mm-hmm. He could care less. Mm-hmm. He could care less if you quote him scripture all day long. Unless you believe it. He measures how big a threat you are by what you believe. He measures how big a threat you are by what you believe. You may spout, oh, I believe the word of God is true. But when rubber meets the road and he looks at your belief system, you don't believe it. You want to believe it, but you don't. That's where the faith
of us being raised from the dead comes from. The fact is, our unbelief is death. If we want to be raised from the dead, if we want to come into the belief of God, we've got to reach out and grab for this day. We've got to realize that this resurrection day is not just to put you back in the family of God, it's to put you back to original design. And that you can't do unless you come to the place where you decide what your relationship is to be with Him. I want to close today by reading this one thing, because we're in the era of the harvest. Okay, this is the decade where we're supposed to be harvesting what God wants us to harvest. Some of that harvest definitely is born again people. We're supposed to be going after people. You should be witnessing to everybody you meet in some form of fashion. Now, some people, I can't come in and start saying, oh, you're going to hell, you need to get Jesus. Okay, I don't think that's always a good way to bring Jesus, okay? Because you're already evoking a lot of things that cause them to, and you're going to hell too, people. Okay, you can't do that. So what I'm going to suggest to you is that there needs to be a place in your relationship with Jesus that when you meet somebody, your spirit already knows, where are they? Where are they in their walk? Are they born again? If they're not born again, let's get after that. If they're born again, let's get after the next step. Because harvest is not just bringing them into salvation or into being born again. Harvest is bringing them into the kingdom so they can be the warriors they need to be so we can advance this stuff against the enemy. So when you're thinking about what this harvest is, first we start with ourselves. Where am I? And second, we realize, how can I present the glory of God and the maturity of God in me when I'm meeting anyone? Sometimes in my witness, the Lord will say, no, you're not going to witness to them the X number of steps to get born again. But you do need to let them know who is your God. So somehow he'll weave in, oh, the Lord loves me and he does this beautiful day. Or he'll say, why are you doing this? Well, Holy Spirit said this was a good day. I mean, you just say Holy Spirit and most people would just freak out. Okay. But what we need to do is stop trying to be nice to people. Are you listening? You need to stop trying to be nice to people. Okay, I don't want to offend you. I don't want to offend you. I don't want to use words that my Savior would use because I might offend your sensibilities. Is that true? Now, the culture tells you, don't interfere with them. Let them be by themselves. But that's not what your God said for you to do. That's not what Jesus did all the work for. So, God told me years ago, you can either be embarrassed by me or embarrassed for me. And I really started saying, you know, if I'm embarrassed for Jesus, that's not such a bad deal. Because he did all this for me. Okay. So I'm going to read you. This is a prayer, and I love these prayers. These are from Dan Duvall. And this is his wonderful prayer. And he tells people, he says, before we go any further, you need to know how to be saved. You'd be surprised the number of people don't know how to be saved. If you ran into someone and they said, I need to know how to be saved, could you lead them to the Lord? Could you actually give them some steps or some guidance or some things on, well, this is what the Lord is. So I want to read you. To choose Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior, we must believe that he is the only begotten Son of the Father. When he came to earth, he was born of a virgin, being entirely God and entirely man. He lived among us, being tempted in all the ways as we are. There is nothing you're doing that he hasn't felt. Yet he was untainted by sin. In this way, he became an acceptable sacrifice for the sins of man. God sent him because he loved the world, and he still does. This means that he loves you, and he sent his son to lay down his life so that he could restore and fulfill yours. God was burdened with an unquenchable love for the whole world. For this love, Jesus died an excruciating, reprehensible, and utterly degenerating death. He was beaten, his hairs were plucked from his face, a crown of thorns was twisted around his scalp, rupturing blood vessels so that the blood poured from his head. He was beaten with a cat of nine tails, a whip with nine strands, often containing shards of metal, bone, and glass. The stripes upon his back were not from bruised or bleeding skin. His flesh was voraciously torn from his back, and the muscles and the bones were left totally exposed. After they were finished, the skin and muscle that was still attached to his body hung in ribbons. Upon his back, they laid a cross, forcing him to carry it all. As he dragged this cross, the weight pressed into his open body, inserting splinters of wood. When he could no longer carry it, the cross was given to another. Yet Jesus was forced to walk the remaining distance to Golgotha. He was dehydrated, and as he walked, the blood that continually dripped into his eyes caused severe burning, and the flesh of his back was totally exposed. He did this for you. At Golgotha, where Jesus was crucified, they laid his body upon the cross naked. They distributed his garments amongst themselves. For all of those who have ever been raped in this moment, Jesus felt that shame. They nailed him to the cross, placing the nails into the major nerves connecting the hands to the central nervous system. They placed a single nail through both of his feet. His legs were not allowed to hang straight, but were fixed so that his knees were bent at a 45 degrees, causing severe and excruciating cramps in his thighs. His muscles fatigued in minutes, but he continued to live for hours. Upon the cross, death came by asphyxiation. In the position that Jesus was nailed to the cross, it was impossible to breathe. It was not that he was gasping for air. The position of the crucifixion caused his lungs to be maximally inflated with air. He had to struggle to breathe out. Jesus had to drag his back up and down the wooden cross for hours before breathing his final breath. In order to drag his open flesh up on the cross, he had to push up on his feet, causing his hands to twist upon the nails that were driven through his nerves. Crucifixion placed the body in such a position that the joints of the arms would slowly become dislocated as the victim suffered. By the time Jesus neared death, all of his bones were out of joint, adding literal inches to the length of his arms. He did this for you. With the face marred beyond recognition, Jesus cried out to God, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" He suffered the ultimate feelings of rejection, because when he became sin for us, he had to be forsaken by his Father in heaven. In the end, the internal complications resulting from crucifixion ruptured the heart of Jesus. When the soldiers pierced his side, blood and water poured out. Jesus died of a heart broken for us. He died that we might live not only eternally, but abundantly. He died to give us the very life of God. He is the acceptable sacrifice, the only sacrifice that God will accept for our sins. So to be saved, we must not only believe that Jesus died, but that he was resurrected on the third day. The victory wasn't in the death, but in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. When he arose, having all power in heaven and on earth, he had the key. He later ascended to heaven and sat down at the right hand of the Father, where he remains to this day, continually making intercession for us. This is the God I serve. This is the God of love. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. the Bible says that if we confess the Lord Jesus Christ with our mouth, and here's the kicker, we believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, we will be saved. If you believe this testimony of Jesus, then you can confess that with your mouth and believe in your heart. And he goes ahead and he writes out the testimony. Jesus, I come before you, and I want you to do this today as I'm reading this. I know you're born again. I know you have Zoe life. But do you have abundant life? Or have you settled for the traditions of men? Have you settled for a lesser life? Do you have the continual bringing you into the place where you have the fullness of God? Are you walking in that place? Because this is what this is about. So when we read this prayer to accept Jesus today, we're accepting him not only as our Savior and our Lord, but he's taking away our sins. We're accepting him that he will return back to us what we were supposed to originally design to be. That we're saying, I want to buy into all the fullness of Resurrection Day. Not just the part where I don't hurt all the time. Okay? So Jesus, I come before you and I acknowledge that I am a sinner. I repent and I call upon your name and I ask you to cleanse me with your blood. Forgive me of my sins. We ask today that God, you forgive us of our sins where we have not believed you fully. Where we have not come into whole agreement with who you say we are. I invite you into my heart, Jesus Christ. I believe that you were born of a virgin, died, and were resurrected on the third day, that I might have eternal life. I open my life to you. I ask you to come in and be my Lord and Savior. I thank you for saving me in Jesus' name. If we prayed that prayer today, you now also have eternal life in Jesus Christ. When you die, you will be immediately escorted to heaven to spend eternity with God. In Jesus, you will find a leader. And this is my prayer for you today. You will find a leader that will never fail you. He will right every wrong, heal every wound. Your hope and your confidence has been placed in the greatest leader the cosmos will ever know. So today, on Resurrection Sunday, we say, Father, we place our lives into your hands. So remove all those traditional barriers that kept us from believing that we could be your fulfilled, completed, spiritual identity warriors that you want us to be. Because we should be taking back the kingdoms that we have in our life. Everyone around us should be born again. And if they are, then we need to move to a place where there are more unborn again. So, Father, give us the understanding of how we are stopping you from walking fully in agreement with who we are. So just as Jesus saw the darkness before he died, and as he looked up and saw the stars, he realized, this is why I did it. For all my family. For the church, for the bride. So Father, we thank you that you have allowed us to be the bride. And now we're asking today that we truly enjoy this Resurrection Sunday in a whole new level than we ever did before. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Dance team gets set up. That's what we're going to do. We're going to enter into worship.
The dance team is going to lead us in the first song, and then we're going to have about four songs after that. And what I want to say is the four songs after the dance teams are all taken from a live praise and worship service in front of the Garden Tomb in Israel. And thank you to Brunel for sending that to me because it was perfect. I tried to hear the songs last night, and I was like, nope, not hearing anything. And I woke up this morning, and that immediately came to my mind. Now, there are no lyrics on those songs. And normally I'm just like, you can deal with that word, it's okay. This time, I felt also an impression to give you those words. So around you in the back of the seats or wherever, there are words, but here's what I want to say. When you enter in, there's many ways to enter into worship. So what the thought that came to me this morning was, whether you know the songs, whether you know the words, it doesn't really matter, because it's whether you know him. And that is what's important. And so whether you choose to use the words and sing with them, whether you choose to just listen to the words and agree in your heart and your spirit, whether you stand, whether you sit, whether you kneel, whether you move, it matters if you know him. And if you know him, you cannot help but praise and worship who he is. So we're going to just enjoy the dance team. The words will be up there for this one. You can sing with them, move with them, whatever you want to do. We'll enjoy them, and then we'll move into the other songs as well.
Thank you. table, the upper room where we recline. You raised the cup and said, your blood and water's the wine. You said your body would be broken, life is red. It was a kind of love that we just could not comprehend. Lie, lie, lie. There in the garden, falling on your knees, you pray. Abba, Father, won't you take this cup away? Then you betray with an army entering in, trading your love for 30 shekels and a kiss. Lie, lie, lie. Your body beating, a crown of thorns upon your head. We nailed you to the tree, the final word you said. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And it was finished. Let you in the ballroom to lie, 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 lie. Come and see where he lay.
God. God sent his son. They called him Yeshua. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon, an empty grave. My Savior lived. Because he lived, I can face tomorrow. Because he lived, all fear is gone. Because I know
From the town of Jesus, Capernaum, and greetings from my friends around the world. So join me this April 7th on my YouTube channel, our Garden of Live Resurrection Premiere. I'll see you there.
And this next song, we send you out with a blessing. Blessings from the Lord.
Thank you.
Father, we come with thankful and grateful hearts that we get to participate in this resurrection. And Father, I personally ask for forgiveness for not taking each year and each resurrection day as a step to go up higher. So I repent, and we repent for staying settled. We settled for a life that you did not intend for us to settle. It's our time to be just like our Savior and rise above the things the enemy planned for your life. It's time to rise above the problems, the hurts, the betrayals. It's time to come into that place where we can identify with his sufferings, but we identify with his glory as well. So, Father, we take this day as an opportunity to say thank you for sending your son, Jesus. Jesus, we take this day to say a thank you that we cannot ever, ever fully come into the understanding of what we did. We say thank you for loving us. Even when we said, Holy Spirit, thank you for guiding us and leading us and filling us with the same power that you filled Jesus with on the resurrection. So we receive this power to overcome all that the enemy would set before. As we look high and see that Jesus has already finished the work. And he lives every breath making intercession for us to do the same. We give you the praise and the glory.